Good morning, and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Danbury. My name is Sam McCoy, and I'm thrilled to be celebrating James Baldwin with you this morning as we approach his 100th birthday coming in August. At different points, I'm going to deviate a bit from some of our usual sequences, so I hope you'll be open to that. But to start, I'll still ask that you please silence your phones or any devices that you have with you if you haven't done so already. Thank you for being here today. Every single one of you enhances this experience by your presence, and I'm grateful that you chose to join us. There's space for you in this worship service, and together we will make this a time of community, support, friendship, kindness, and inspiration. Be present in whatever way feels right to you. As we gather this morning, we respectfully acknowledge that our physical building is on the traditional, unceded land of the Paugusset people. And to open this time of worship and reflection, I'd like to share some opening words from James Baldwin, the focus of this hour. The first is from a collection of essays that was published under the title Notes of a Native Son, and it was first published in 1955. He wrote, "I love America more than any other country in the world, and exactly for this reason, I insist on the right to criticize her perpetually." And then in 1979, one of his later books was titled Just Above My Head. And there he wrote, "Not everything is lost. Responsibility cannot be lost. It can only be abdicated. If one refuses abdication, one begins again." So now I invite you to take a moment to greet your neighbors, either here next to you, joining us online. Say hello, introduce yourself to someone you haven't met yet, or maybe wave at some friends across the hall.
Welcome again. I better stand closer. Welcome again to our service, both those of you who are here in person and those who are joining online. My name is Todd Zagorek. I'm with the Sunday Services Committee. And recently, in a moment of weakness, I agreed to join the Board of Trustees as well. And in a moment of perhaps greater weakness, many of you voted to confirm that. So I will try my best not to let you down. We have a few announcements. Reverend Tony is away on vacation. He will be away through August 18th. And if you have a pastoral care emergency in the meantime, please contact Joan Campbell. I hope that's not a surprise to you, Joan. Good. And Joan can put you in touch with the minister that's providing vacation backup for Tony. This coming September, there will be two opportunities to join a chalice circle for monthly reflection with other members of the congregation. The two circles will be the second Sundays of the month after the service at 11:45 to 12:45, with the meeting room to be determined, with Marcia Brooker facilitating, or the third Tuesdays of the month at 1 p.m. in the minister's office with Tony. And if you're interested in participating in either of those chalice circles, please contact Tony. And if you haven't done so already, please take time to fill out the congregational survey from the Sunday Services team. The link can be found in the July comment. And we do review those. It's important. So please, if you remember, take a moment and fill out that survey. It will help us. It'll help us to design our programming for the coming year. Okay, so Sam says we have 26 responses to the survey so far. So if you haven't responded, please do so. It is important. And for more information, please see your order of service, the weekly email newsletter, and the events calendar on the website. And now it's time for our chalice lighting. We make this time and place holy simply by being together. And we begin by lighting the chalice as a symbol of our Unitarian Universalist tradition. So please join me as Diane Purvis lights the chalice for us in the recitation of our affirmation. Is it not working? Okay, you press that button and hold, and that keeps that engaged. You have to press the circle. There we go. It can be a challenge. Okay. Press and hold. Press and hold.
I am.
Oh, it's turned off. Try again. Yeah. There we go. All right. Got it. Thank you. Love is the spirit of this congregation, and justice is its light. This is our covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek and speak the truth in love, to help one another and celebrate life. Please rise in body or spirit and join in singing our hymn of welcome, Just As Long As I Have Breath. It's number 6 in the gray hymnal, if you have that. And the words are also on the screen.
Todd and I have a little bit of a height differential going on here.
We'll work it out. Before our story, let's say our children's affirmation, so please join me. We are Unitarian Universalists. We are people with open minds, loving hearts, and helping hands. We care for the earth and each other. So this morning's story is titled The All Together Quilt, and you will be able to follow along on the screen, and I will read here from the printed version. Oh, and I'll point out before I start the story, this is based on an actual quilting group in Norwalk, Connecticut. So I was like, oh, what a lovely coincidence. And the author and illustrator is named Lizzie Rockwell. Jennifer and her friends meet on Fridays at the community center. They are making a quilt. Everyone works together. First, Jennifer picks a fabric from the dark colors. Fran picks a fabric from the light colors. Jennifer traces a shape on the dark fabric. Then she traces a shape on the light fabric. Fran cuts out the two shapes. Jennifer pins them together. Fran sews them together. Richard and Maurice work together. They trace and cut and pin and sew. Look, two triangles together make one square. Two rectangles together make one square. Fran and Jennifer, Richard and Maurice, Sana and Melissa, Anna Mae and Trinity, Maria and Jocelyn. Ooh, come on in. I see people at the door. Come on in, people. Join us. Nadaline and Viola, Angela and Betty, Ernestine and Zach. Together in pairs, they make 8 squares. Except for Naika. Naika works on 1 blue square. She uses special pens and paints and brushes. Next, they arrange the squares. They turn them and move them this way and that. There are so many combinations. The last one they try is their favorite. This quilt will have a border around 4 sides. Jocelyn measures and Anna Mae cuts 4 white rectangles. The pieces look plain, but not for long. Anna helps Jennifer cover the palm of her hand with paint. Jennifer presses her hand onto the fabric, and friends are invited to make handprints too. Now all the pieces are ready. Labels show which piece goes where. They pin and sew and iron all the pieces together, and soon the patchwork is complete. Now it is time to layer the quilt. The layers are held in place with basting stitches. The quilt is attached to 2 wooden rods. It's rolled tight and stretched across sawhorses. At the frame, Sana learns to stitch. She pokes the needle down from the top and back up from below. It's hard to find the right spot. She practices and learns. It takes a long time to quilt the quilt. Everybody lends a hand. On many, many Fridays, they sit and stitch and talk together. Finally, the last stitch is stitched. The quilt is taken off the frame. It is trimmed into a neat square. Dot sews on a purple binding to close the edges. Many hands work together to make this beautiful quilt. But who will have it now that it is done? Everyone will have it. It hangs in the library for all to see. It's the quilt that Jennifer and her friends made all together. The end. So at this point, we invite any children who'd like to go downstairs. We do have childcare, although we have no formal classes in the summer, or you are welcome to stay in the service as well, your choice. But either way, we are going to sing This Little Light of Mine, so please join me.
It's time for our milestones. And as we move into our time of shared milestones, let's take a moment with some words adapted from a piece by the Reverend Tess Baumberger. From the busyness of every day, we gather once a week to remember who we are, to dream of who we might become. As companions on this journey, we share the milestones we meet along the way. Individual moments of joy and sorrow become shared moments of comfort and celebration. And we travel this road together.
Breathe in, breathe out, breathe in, breathe.
Today's reading is taken from the Pulitzer and Nobel Prize winning Toni Morrison's Eulogy for James Baldwin, delivered on the 20th of December, 1987. Jimmy, there is too much to think about you and too much to feel. The difficulty is your life refuses summation, it always did, and invites contemplation instead. Like many of us left here, I thought I knew you. Now I discover that in your company it is myself I know. That is the astonishing gift of your art and your friendship. You gave us ourselves to think about, to cherish. I never heard a single command from you, yet the demands you made on me, the challenges you issued to me, were nevertheless unmistakable, even if unenforced. That I work and think at the top of my form, that I stand on moral ground, but know that ground must be shored up by mercy, that the world is before me, and I need not take it or leave it as it was when I came in. Well, the season was always Christmas with you there. And like one aspect of that scenario, you did not neglect to bring at least three gifts. You gave me a language to dwell in, a gift so perfect it seems my own invention. I've been thinking your spoken and written thoughts for so long I believed they were mine. I've been seeing the world through your eyes for so long I believed that clear, clear view was my own. The second gift was your courage, which you let us share, the courage of one who could go as a stranger in the village and transform the distances between people into intimacy with the whole world. Courage to understand that experience in ways that made it a personal revelation for each of us. The third gift was hard to fathom and even harder to accept. It was your tenderness, a tenderness so delicate I thought it could not last, but last it did, and envelop me it did. You knew, didn't you, how I needed your language and the mind that formed it, how I relied on your fierce courage to tame wildernesses for me, how strengthened I was by the certainty that came from knowing you would never hurt me. You knew, didn't you, how I loved your love. You knew. This then is no calamity. No, this is jubilee. Our crown, you said, has already been bought and paid for. All we have to do, you said, is wear it. And we do, Jimmy. You crowned us. So ends the reading. Now it's time for our offering. When you give your time and energy to this congregation, you donate to its support. And you're giving gifts to each other. Everyone who gives or receives a gift does so with gratitude and generosity. Together we give to the community around us. In order to make your gift this morning, you can use the link or the QR code posted in the chat or projected onto the screen, or you can always mail a check to 24 Clapboard Ridge Road in Danbury. And thank you for your generosity.
Bear with me for a moment here. There we go. Okay. All right. Thought I had left it in the right place, but I didn't. Okay, now I'm good. So the first time I remember seeing James Baldwin's name was in the summer of 1993 as I looked over lists of summer reading required before my senior English class in high school. Giovanni's Room was one of the novels on the list, authored by Baldwin. I didn't know anything about James Baldwin, but it was on the list, and I was a rule follower, so I went looking for it. And as it turns out, in 1993, before the internet and even before most of the giant booksellers were established in my area, it wasn't always easy to get your hands on a copy of a novel by a queer Black author published some 35 years earlier. And in the end, I was never actually able to get a copy of Giovanni's Room that summer. I ended up choosing something different from the reading list, and my academic life moved forward. When I was in college, I was required to take 2 semesters of English courses. And as much as I have enjoyed the study of history from a young age, I didn't always enjoy the study of literature in the same way. So I completed that minimum, and then I went right back to the study of history, religion, and languages that I found more to my liking. And unfortunately, neither of my 2 literature courses included any works by Baldwin. So he and I continued to miss each other in my academic career. It was around 2011, maybe 2012, when I switched from teaching the early portion of US history to a course that focused on the 20th century, that I finally encountered Baldwin in a meaningful way. And some of you have heard me say this before, but it wasn't until I was required to teach other people about the mid-20th century, including the civil rights movement, that I really began to study it in more detail. Then fast forward to 2020 with COVID raging and the US in the midst of what felt like a societal reckoning after the deaths of Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, George Floyd, and too many others, I found myself leaning on Baldwin's writings to help me make sense of what was happening. Today, I want us all to spend some time contemplating the life and the work of James Baldwin, who would turn 100 on August 2nd this year, were he still alive. Across the century since his birth, Baldwin's impact echoes across US scholarship and, I would argue, our understanding of what it means to be an American. Part of what makes the life of James Baldwin fascinating is his placement in space and time. We could think of this as how he began to find his spot in our metaphorical American quilt that we're going to think about today. He was born in 1924, coming of age in Harlem during the Great Depression and at the start of World War II. He was born to a mother from Maryland who went to Harlem as part of the great migration of African Americans that spanned the 19-teens, 20s, and 30s. Not a whole lot is known about his birth father, but his stepfather, who adopted him upon marrying James's mother, was also an internal refugee from the South and a Baptist preacher by trade. Both of his parents were descended from people who had been enslaved, and that ugly legacy inside our US story was already embedded deep in his DNA and passed down through the generations. By the time Baldwin was 19, his mother had given birth to his 8 siblings. His stepfather had passed away. He had left high school early to begin earning money to support the family, and he had discovered his passion for writing. As early as his junior high school years, the written word would come to be the primary way Baldwin processed his thoughts, connected with the wider world, and advocated for social change. By 1948, James Baldwin decided it was time to leave the United States. And this is another inflection point in his story, in finding his place in our American quilt, even while he's overseas. He was eager to turn his love for writing into a career and believed Paris would be the place to make that happen. Baldwin would end up spending about 9 years in Paris, where he published many essays, including the collection that became Notes of a Native Son, as well as his first 2 novels, one of which was the aforementioned Giovanni's Room. He made many friends and developed some intimate relationships during his time in Paris, but he felt a consistent tug to return to the United States, which he did in 1957. He was overseas for the Brown versus Board of Ed ruling, but home in time to watch the unfolding of school integration across the South and the rising influence of a certain young Baptist preacher from Atlanta, Georgia, who would help set a movement in motion and become one of Baldwin's friends. Baldwin once remarked that he needed to return to the U.S. in order to, quote, pay his dues, as so many U.S. Black Americans were doing during their day-to-day lives as the civil rights movement grew. While he would also spend time throughout the 1960s and into the early 1970s living part-time in Istanbul, he was tied to the freedom movement in the U.S. and connected with many of its leaders. Baldwin developed friendships and deep connections with leaders across the spectrum, from Medgar Evers to Martin Luther King to Malcolm X. But he was rarely the face at the front of protests or demonstrations. It doesn't even feel entirely accurate to describe him as working behind the scenes. In some instances, that was literally true, but more often, Baldwin was documenting what he saw and bearing witness to the lived experiences of Americans struggling against injustice. While he was an active member of the Congress of Racial Equality, known as CORE, and was in contact and went to meetings with Robert F. Kennedy when RFK was Attorney General, most of Baldwin's advocacy came through the written word. He made numerous television appearances, including a rather famous Cambridge debate against William F. Buckley in 1965, as well as some appearances on the Dick Cavett Show. He continued to be a voice for freedom in the U.S. until his death from cancer in 1987. He is interred at Ferncliff Cemetery in Hartsdale, New York, in a plot he shares with his mother. At this point, now we've established some basic facts about Baldwin's biography, and that's a good start. But what is it about this author, this child of Harlem, this man who grappled with a difficult-to-define sexuality? A quiet leader who developed friendships with the prominent civil rights leaders of his day. What is it that makes him notable? What exactly is his legacy? Why should we take the time to mark his centennial? Baldwin's style of writing and speaking is eloquent, elevated, and very clearly enunciated. For some writers, the use of those descriptors would mean that the material looks good on paper, but the writing didn't necessarily hit its mark, and that is not the case with James Baldwin. When he begins an argument, particularly regarding racism in the U.S., he cuts straight to the heart of the issue. He will not spare your feelings. He's not interested in giving the reader any easy comfort. He expects you to be there with him, feeling his experience and living in the sometimes painful realities. This is true for both his nonfiction essays and the characters he develops in his novels. Baldwin's not there to give you a conventionally fun reading experience. And if we think about Baldwin and we picture this American quilt, sort of living in my mind here, it's also essential to see the squares that surround him, the squares that inspired him, and then in turn the ones he helped lay the pattern for in the future. Although I doubt Baldwin would have ever described himself as a historian or sociologist, he works with history and societal frameworks in some of the same ways as the noted Black sociologist W.E.B. Du Bois. Born in 1868, at least two generations ahead of Baldwin, Du Bois was an academic tour de force. He was the first African-American to earn a PhD from Harvard, but he did some of his graduate work in Berlin. And during that time in Berlin, Du Bois once commented, quote, "I found myself on the outside of the American world looking in. With me were white folk, students, acquaintances, teachers, who viewed the scene with me. They did not always pause to regard me as a curiosity or something subhuman. I was just a man of the somewhat privileged student rank with whom they were glad to meet and talk over the world, particularly the part of the world whence I came." End quote. It's not hard to imagine that Baldwin felt similarly among the group of friends, neighbors, and the writing colleagues he found both in Paris and Istanbul. Both men went abroad at various times in their lives, often frustrated with how it felt to exist as a Black man in the United States. Ultimately, Du Bois lost his will to remain in the U.S., and he lived the end of his life in Ghana. Baldwin, however, continued to return, and as Professor Eddie Glaude wrote of Baldwin in 2020, "No matter what happened, we were and would always be American. The future of Black people in this country resided not in some fantastical elsewhere, but here. Baldwin never changed his mind about that." End quote. We can also find echoes of Ida B. Wells Barnett in Baldwin's work, as she would have another square, I think, nearby in the quilt. Like Baldwin, Wells Barnett made her living as a writer and used her journalistic skills to bring attention to the lynching epidemic spreading across the U.S. in the 1880s and 90s. She was born into an enslaved family in Mississippi in 1862 and lived through waves of racial violence in both Mississippi and then Memphis before she eventually relocated to Chicago. One of her more famous speeches was delivered in 1909 at a gathering called the National Negro Conference, and she laid out specific statistics on lynching in that speech. And at one point she said, quote, "No other nation, civilized or savage, burns its criminals. Only under that stars and stripes is the human Holocaust possible. 28 human beings burned at the stake, one of them a woman and two of them children, is the awful indictment against American civilization, the gruesome tribute which the nation pays to the color line," end quote. Similarly, James Baldwin could use his words to cut right to the heart of a problem. And one time he did that was during the 1965 debate at Cambridge against William F. Buckley. The question in that debate was whether progress for the American dream came at the expense of African Americans. And we're going to play you a part of his opening statement in that debate.
And now, we're speaking about expense. I suppose there are several ways to address oneself to some attempt to define what that word means here. Let me put it this way, that from a very literal point of view, the harbors and the ports and the railroads of the country, the economy, especially of the southern states, could not conceivably be what it has become if they had not had, and do not still have indeed, and for so long, so many generations, cheap labor. I am stating very seriously, and this is not an overstatement, that I and I carried it to market. And I built the railroads under someone else's whip for nothing. For nothing. The southern oligarchy, which has until today so much power in Washington, and therefore some power in the world, was created by my labor and my sweat, and the violation of my women, and the murder of my children. This, in the land of the free, and the home of the brave. And no one can challenge that statement. It is a matter of historical record.
We can notice familiar patterns in their similar styles. Both he and Wells Barnett incorporate the patriotic language that would be familiar to many in the US. The stars and stripes, the land of the free, the home of the brave. Baldwin's able to weave his lived experience with that of his ancestors. And as the kids say today, Ida B. Wells brought the receipts, and Baldwin does the same. And this is not to say that the work was easy for Baldwin. Bearing witness to daily or ritualized cruelties certainly took its toll on his physical and mental health. He could engage in self-destructive habits. He even attempted suicide. And this was before the deaths of Medgar and Malcolm and Martin piled up on him in the 1960s. And by the end of that decade, there were times when Baldwin seemed broken and maybe had lost his faith in the American experiment. And perhaps there were moments when he would have liked to just tear his square away from the community quilt and just walk away. But he didn't. And instead, as Professor Glaude reminds us, he chose to begin again. Looking at our present day and into the future, ripples of Baldwin's work show up in those Black intellectuals who were both his contemporaries and those who followed in his footsteps. Toni Morrison's elegantly incisive prose feels like it grew, at least partly, from her affection for and her admiration for her friend Jimmy. I saw Baldwin's patterns when Nicole Hannah Jones created the 1619 Project. One example is when she refers to the plantations of enslavers as forced labor camps. Once again, it's brutal honesty that doesn't care about the audience's comfort. And as a side note, I used that with a bunch of eighth graders on a tour of Mount Vernon a couple of years ago. The kids were not nearly as taken aback as the DC tour guide was when I got going. I don't think she loved it. That's okay. When I read Clint Smith, an impactful poet and Atlantic essayist, and his discussions of how we as Americans remember our history, I can picture Baldwin just cheering for Smith. In his book, How the Word is Passed, Smith is a welcoming and amiable tour guide around sites of enslavement across the US, but he's brutally honest in his reckoning about their impact across time. Smith, like Baldwin, forces his readers to see the lies they've been told and the purposeful omissions in public memory so that we can become better as a nation. I conceived the concept for this service earlier this spring, and I settled on my quilt metaphor and imagery about a month ago. It then felt quite serendipitous 3 weeks ago, like perhaps the universe was pointing me in the right direction, when Reverend Dr. Molly Hausch Gordon delivered her sermon at General Assembly titled Weaving Our Lives. If you were not able to watch it that week when we were together, I commend it to you, and I suggest that you find it online. She spoke of many aspects of the interdependent web of life, but she returned regularly to a concept her grandmother taught her. Before one can weave, one should learn to mend. The mending we do in our day-to-day existence, for ourselves, for our families, our communities, for the stranger, that's what keeps our interdependent web functioning. We're each more secure thanks to the effort of others to mend, to weave, perhaps even to quilt. In this great United States quilt that currently resides in my mind's eye, I can picture the Baldwin of 60 years ago carefully, steadily, and wholly intentionally working on his own square, but along the way, he was also repairing the tattered edges of the squares from Wells Barnett, Du Bois, and countless others. His square is uniquely his own, but he also wants it to work in harmony with his elders. As new generations arrive and new voices take their places in our society, they can look at Baldwin Square and they can use it as inspiration for their own. Baldwin also calls on us, rather directly, to mend the places where earlier squares are torn, where the binding is coming undone, or where someone near us is struggling with their stitches, to repair a nation that continues to struggle to define itself and to create beloved community. There are a myriad of viewpoints and patterns that can fill the squares in our nation's quilt. And indeed, they're all required in order to have the full picture of who we are and build the sense of community that we seek. We as individuals don't have to find every square appealing in order to recognize the beauty of the overall pattern. And if we isolate ourselves and simply stitch our own closed pattern over and over again, we don't do much good for the larger project. Today, as our nation finds its way through a complex political and culture-shifting period, may we offer open minds and open hearts to each other. May we practice our commitment to beginning again and mending our American quilt, allowing it to continue to grow and provide what we need for another 248 years and beyond. So for all that was Baldwin's life, I chose our hymn of celebration, so I invite you to rise in body and our spirit to sing number 128, For All That Is Our Life.
Thank you.
Please join me in the words for extinguishing the chalice. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts and out into the world until we are together again.
Thank you, Carl. Beautiful.
As we heard from Baldwin at the beginning of the service, remember, not everything is lost. Responsibility cannot be lost, it can only be abdicated. And if one refuses abdication, one begins again. And maybe today we begin again with coffee and cake. So please join us for refreshments.